Welcome to this first of our public conversation series, which is a special feature of the NYUAD Abu Dhabi Institute here in Abu Dhabi. As many of you are repeat visitors from last year or even earlier this week, but about half of you also are new and fresh faces to us. So I'm going to take a minute to say a few things about the goals of New York University Abu Dhabi and why we have these events. My name is Mariette Westerman. I'm the provost of New York University Abu Dhabi. NYU Abu Dhabi will open next year as a comprehensive liberal arts and science college, offering a wide range of programs in the arts, humanities, sciences, social sciences, and engineering. It will offer a full four-year Bachelor's of Arts and Science program. In addition, and it will be part of a really exciting research-driven campus that will stand in a very tight relationship, as you'll learn tonight, to the major research university that is New York University in New York, and in its many global extensions with our campuses abroad. You will hear much more this coming year about NYU Abu Dhabi as an educational and research institution. But when we first started building this institution here last year, and we've been very excited to do that, we thought it was very important to begin to bring a sense of the research heft and interest and the wide range of programs that NYU offers in New York and will offer here by bringing some of our best faculty here. And I am very, and not only our best faculty, but also often our alumni. And so I hope that you've all picked up one of our programs for this fall, where you'll see the wide range of activities we bring from all the fields that will be represented in the university. We've kicked off this week with a special focus on art and architecture. And I'm delighted that that has drawn out so many of you, even on this first evening of the weekend. Tonight, we will have a public conversation between Yasser Tabbaa and Jean-Louis Cohen, the gentleman on the stage. Yasser Tabbaa, on the left, will engage Jean-Louis in a conversation about Le Corbusier's landmark publication, Vers une architecture, of 1923. About, if you have never read that, I don't want to say you should have, although I recommend it, Vers une architecture, as you'll learn, was truly a landmark publication that transformed the way, almost immediately, overnight, the way architects and thinkers about architecture, art critics, and so forth, thought about the relationship between architecture, technology, and history in the modern age. And that's all I'm going to say, because they are much more expert at it than I am. Let me tell you something about our two speakers. I promised them that I would not give a roll call of their CVs, because they are old friends and colleagues, and so I didn't want to really read up on them too much because I thought I should know it, and they preferred that. Yasser Tabbaa, who gave a talk here just a couple of days ago on Christian imagery on Islamic vessels, or vessels produced in Islamic contexts. Yasser is currently the head of the Department of Ethics, Philosophy, and Religion at the King's Academy in Amman, Jordan. He is a native, well, really of Saudi Arabia, but grew up in a Jordanian-Syrian family, and only recently returned to Amman, first to become Dean of Arts at the University of Jordan, and then recently he joined his very exciting new venture, the King's Academy, that you may be aware of. Yasser comes with a wide-ranging background, intellectual background, which you will have picked up if you were at his talk before, and it makes him so ideally suited to engage with Jean-Louis Cohen. Yasser did his undergraduate work in sociology. He holds a PhD from the Institute of Fine Arts at New York University, my own alma mater, in the history of Islamic architecture. He has been involved in heritage management. He's been a professor at top institutions like the University of Michigan and Oberlin College. He really comes with a very wide-ranging set of interests. And as some of you who were here for the for his talk will have noticed, especially in the question and answer period, he is a positively walking and talking encyclopedia of the history of Arabic politics and culture and so forth. And we're delighted that this very cosmopolitan man will engage his equally cosmopolitan counterpart, Professor Jean-Louis Cohen. Jean-Louis is the Sheldon Solow Professor in the History of Modern Architecture at the Institute of Fine Arts, that same institution again, the Institute of Fine Arts at New York University. He has among the widest ranging interests of any historian of architecture I know, and a deep relationship to buildings that comes also out of his training as an architect. He was trained as an architect and then later obtained his PhD in architecture from the École, or actually in history, I should say, in the École des Hautes Études en Sciences Sociales in Paris, and again comes with that same wide range of interests that makes him such an effective teacher. He has written and studied modern architecture in its widest extensions, from Russia and the Soviet Union to modern Germany, of course, of course, France, where he is indeed a great expert on Le Corbusier, as you'll learn. But he's also published on colonial architectural cultures of Northern Africa. He's published important books on Algeria and also on Casablanca, for example. It's a deep personal commitment for him. Both Yasser and Jean-Louis, to me, exemplify the kind of teaching that we hope to bring to New York University Abu Dhabi, deeply engaged with their material, but also deeply committed to transmitting knowledge to students and involving students in the making of that knowledge. At one point, if I may, one personal anecdote, at one point earlier, before I became the provost here, I was director of the Institute of Fine Arts, where Jean-Louis was my colleague. And every year he would come to me and ask, can I take the students to Rome? There's a great exhibition on this or that. Can I take them to Barcelona together with my colleague from Barcelona? Because the students really need to see these things. And this is exactly the kind of education that NYU Abu Dhabi will try to bring to the many students from all over the world and the region will bring here. And I've never had more sleepless nights than when Jean-Louis took the ball off one night, these students off, these fine graduate students to Los Angeles, and I was receiving reports of nocturnal efforts to scale walls and fences and broken ankles and so forth. He really goes the extra mile to teach, and I think you will get a sense of that tonight. I've spoken too long already. Please, ladies and gentlemen, welcome Yasser Tabbaa and Jean-Louis Cohen.
Thank you all for coming. We will begin with Professor Jean-Louis Cohen, whom I will call Jean-Louis, and he'll call me Yasser. Jean-Louis will present us with a brief introduction to the architecture and thought process of Le Corbusier, as illustrated in his book, Vers une architecture, Towards an Architecture.
Many thanks. Does this work? Many thanks, Yasser. Many thanks, Mariette, for your generous and witty introduction. Many thanks to Philip Kennedy, who organized this. So I'm not exceptionally here to discuss a book I wrote, but a book I edited in a new English translation, and a book which I think is probably the most important of an important figure of modern culture. This man is Le Corbusier, born Charles-Édouard Jeanneret in Switzerland in 1887. He died on the Riviera. He had a stroke while swimming on the Riviera in August 1965. So his life basically spans the first two-thirds of the 20th century. And he has left behind not only one book, but probably 45 to 50 books, not counting the translations. He has made 400 architectural designs and built 75 of them. And he has left an extraordinary archive in Paris of 1.5 million documents. So I'm just pointing to these numbers to give you an image of the of his ambition and of his productivity as a design professional. Le Corbusier is known for his bold designs, which have changed the way in which we consider architecture, which have changed the way in which we live. The best examples, perhaps, in the 1920s of his first style of his first manner is Villa Savoye on the left, built on the outskirts of Paris, which was a bland modernist statement, which inspired many architects throughout the world. 20 years later, he completely contradicted himself and bounced back with the lyrical shapes of the chapel at Ronchamp, which you see on the right. Le Corbusier designed and built buildings. He was also a city planner, an inventor of city forms, and one who, because of his radical designs, has often been considered as one of the authors of the repetitive and industrialized way of building cities that has devastated a large part of the planet. This is rather unfair in my view, and we have to consider his designs as very complex objects, some of which were in fact built at the contact of non-European civilizations. So on the left here, you see the curves of his plan for Algiers of 1931. On the right, the plan of the only city he ever completely built, the city of Chandigarh in Indian Punjab, which remains one of the most marking statements of modernism in planning, yet open to many inputs of Indian civilization. Le Corbusier was also a painter, and a very good one. This is one of his most significant paintings of the 1920s, which is in the collection of the Museum of Modern Art in New York. Le Corbusier painted hundreds of paintings, and from his work in the painting studio, he developed many of the shapes he would later use in architecture and city planning. If I get back for 1 second to the curves of the plan of Algiers, which is by many aspects a very brutal scheme, they are clearly related to his paintings. And of course, this is what brings us here tonight. Le Corbusier used the book as a powerful tool for the expression of his ideas about, not only about the city or about architecture, but about the modern world. Here, a range of books published in relationship with an avant-garde magazine he founded in 1920 with the painter Aux Enfants. This magazine was called L'Esprit Nouveau, the New Spirit, and in a way tried to situate architecture and the arts within modern life, in relationship to technology, to the emerging art of cinema, to psychoanalysis, to politics. From the pages of his articles in L'Esprit Nouveau, Le Corbusier published in 1923 his major work, Toward an Architecture, if I translate the French title Vers une architecture faithfully. The book was mistranslated and beginning with its title in 1927 and called Towards a New Architecture. And generations of Anglophone architects and architectural students have read this rather incorrect translation. So the book we're here to discuss tonight is not exactly a new book. It's a newly found book. It's a book reinvented thanks to a competent translation, which is not my work, but the work of John Goodman, an excellent translator in New York. What I did was to put this book in context with a sort of overkill of an introduction of 100 pages, which helps to understand the significance of the book. Important news for the English for the Arabic readers, this book is currently in the process of translation thanks to the Kalima program. As far as I know, I have no news of its status, but I had a discussion about permissions and
some aspects of a translation last year, so maybe you will one of these days see the Arabic translation emerge in your favorite bookstore. So let me very quickly leaf through several issues featured in the book. The book was striking, first of all, as an aesthetic object. For many centuries, architectural books had text and plates, but not assembled in order to give, as in a edited film, as in a film after montage, a sort of sequence of shocking views. And when Le Corbusier presented these images in a book of architecture of airplanes, or his interpretation of classical buildings, it was indeed a shock. He used, in fact, the techniques of persuasion of publicity. So we see here the contrast between two aspects of his book, looking at modern technologies, eyes that do not see the airplanes should look at them, and also on the right, regulating lines, keeping in your field of vision not only airplanes but also the classical issues of architecture. So very quickly, Le Corbusier in his book discussed the buildings by the engineers telling, this is what you see on the right with his image of a sort of carafe tap looking building, scorning the work of the architects, telling, for instance, look at the work of American engineers, but on the left, radical factories, industrial buildings, but ignore the work of American architects. So the engineer was presented as the new ideal for modern design. He drew the attention of his contemporaries on airplanes, on ocean liners, where he found some of the shapes of his buildings and also on automobiles. But at the same time, he was also careful to revise and to reinterpret the grand past of architecture, learning and teaching the lesson of Rome on the left with his sketches from Villa Adriana and from his useful trips to Rome. He would illustrate also his discussion of the surface of buildings with views of Rome. And nowhere is this contrast more obvious than in the famous, one of the most famous pages of any single book of architecture ever printed, that you see on the left, the confrontation of the Parthenon and the Delage car. What is the point here? That the car projects a mechanical perfection which is similar to the one of the Pantheon. That the Pantheon, in fact, had been a powerful machine to produce emotions because of its mathematical precision, which is repeated in the motor car. Le Corbusier also, in his book, in this book, reflected, and this is what makes this man so puzzling and so ambiguous. On one hand, he is preaching for the architecture of the modern times. On the other hand, he looks at historical images with a great attention. What you see on the left is a 16th century view of Rome by Piero Ligorio, in which you see Rome not as a continuous fabric of blocks, but as a collection of solitary objects. This is exactly the type of structure Le Corbusier projected later for cities like Chandigarh. So in fact, his bolder statements about the modern city were directly derived from his observations of Rome in situ, or in this case, among the books of the Bibliothèque Nationale in Paris. And if there is one person who is the inspiration and the key figure, in Versian architecture, it is Michelangelo, to whom Le Corbusier dedicated this little portrait in 1917, writing to Michelangelo tenderly and respectfully. Now, finally, let me just insist on also the what I would call the manipulative aspect of this book, which is very interesting and sometimes surprising. Here we see all the little sketches I have found about the layout of the book, how the book should be organized Le Corbusier collected images in many sources and put them on the pages, but sometimes he improved them. So one could say that he had invented Photoshop before the hour. You see here this comparison of the same grain, American grain elevators published by Walter Gropius, the founder of the Bauhaus on the left. And you see that the bottom on the left, the bottom one, has little pediments. On the right, the same image as published by Le Corbusier has lost the pediments. He has used white gouache to take them out in order to modernize much more, to radicalize the silhouette of these buildings. Another example, which is extraordinary, on the right is a page on Byzantine Rome, where Le Corbusier publishes the image of a lovely little Roman church of Santa Maria in Cosmedin. And on the left, the original image which by Alinari, which I found, which is not in his archive, and you see that he has crossed out and eliminated the columns, the capital, the sculpture, in order also to give a modern look to this early Christian church. So this book was full of slogans, full of very powerful demonstrations, which in a way entered the mind of young architects in the entire world. The book was translated almost immediately in German, in English, in Japanese, in Spanish, in Buenos Aires, and has been since translated in dozens of languages, and in a way has had probably a more powerful effect on emerging architects than many buildings of Le Corbusier himself. The book also triggered imitations in Russia on the left with Ginsberg, in France on the right with Lursa. So there were many rip-offs, and one could consider that the book is also at the origin of a series of contemporary books which have shaped the architectural discourse since the 60s. When Venturi, Robert Venturi, published in 1972 his book Learning from Las Vegas, it's clear, at least in my view, that he also, that he, it was a clear echo of the learning from Rome position of Le Corbusier, but that the ancient monuments of old Rome had been replaced by the Caesar Palace in Venturi's demonstration. So the book that you can read now, the new English translation, has modified many, many mistakes of the book, and I will just as a conclusion leave you with this double page on the left. On the right is the original page of the book where Le Corbusier orient the architect towards a reflection on volume. And you see on the left that his reminder is translated as mass. It's a very puzzling mistake in the translation by Frederick Etchells, who was a British painter. It's interesting because when in 1932, in an incredibly famous and influential text, Philip Johnson and Henry Russell Hitchcock, one critic and one historian, who by the way taught at our beloved Institute of Fine Arts, Yasser heard his lectures, they wrote that one of the key changes of modern architecture was that mass in old architecture was replaced by volume. So the basic architectural student reading Hitchcock and Johnson on one side and the old translation of Le Corbusier could not make sense out of it. So what I'm trying to do is to help this poor guy. Finally, I want to conclude with this image of an elderly Le Corbusier with a lumberjack shirt in his studio in Paris. And on the right, this drawing for the jacket he designed for the first reprint of Vers d'une Architecture in 1958. It's interesting. Whereas Le Corbusier was constantly rewriting many of his statements and reworking some of his early designs, he republished Vers d'une Architecture without touching it, saying the book as such is a monument. People considered I was a madman when I started making the layout, but it is part of history. I leave it as is. And this is what this edition has tried to do with the edition of the English language. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Jean-Louis, for this detailed introduction, which I'm sure has highlighted many different aspects of the book, Versus une architecture, as well as the legacy of Le Corbusier. And it's actually has answered at least some of the questions, but it has opened other venues for discussion. As far as the circumstances of the publication of this book, I think these have been discussed. But I wanted to go back to the title, which I've always loved. Vers une architecture, the word in architecture. There's something kinetic, dynamic about it. Did he mean it as a manifesto? Did he mean it as an object that is unchanging? Or is there something of a template, an open book for new architects to follow?
No, it's clearly it's a mysterious title, and the origin of the title is not so clear. One could, a friend of mine, Stanislaus von Moos, who is a very good Le Corbusier scholar, who has written the first really serious biography, told me that it might have been derived from a book by Walter Rathenau, the German industrialist and politician who had written a book called Von Kommenden Dingen, about things which are coming. So this idea of a movement is one idea. The other one is, I think, in a deeper way, one could also see in the book the very movement of the ocean liners, which are featured on its pages. But what I perceive is the idea that architecture, in the mind of Le Corbusier, architecture is not possible if you don't draw, and I'm talking the present tense as if we were 1923, architecture is possible only, is not possible if you don't draw all the conclusions from the age of the machine. If you continue to build classical facade in front of a reinforced concrete structure, you have to draw the conclusions, and only then, with this reintegration, as Hitchcock would have said, with this reintegration of technology and of the new values given by the machines, will be a real architecture possible. So it's not going to, as in the first English text, towards a new architecture. It's going toward architecture period in the noblest definition of this art.
Well, the mention of the machine leads to the second thought, I think a very important thought for Corbusier. In fact, in a recent lecture at the Barbican Le Corbusier exhibition, you spoke of Corbusier's lyricism in the machine age and the aesthetics of the machine. For many of us, that appears as a paradox. What did he mean by that, the aesthetics of the machine or the...
Yes. Le Corbusier was a man of paradoxes and of oxymorons. He talked, for instance, of the vertical garden city. What is a vertical garden city? Difficult to grasp. It's a building where you find balconies large enough to become gardens in the sky. And it's a concept which is still very much in the air, if I may say so.
The hanging gardens of Babylon,
yeah,
maybe.
In the making of new types of skyscrapers in this part of the world and as far as China. So he was a man he uses paradoxes in many ways. And discussing his point was, and I will use some of his images, if looking at the Parthenon, he was saying that the Parthenon has an ability to move us, was producing emotions. And it was producing emotions because of the precision with which it had been made. It was producing emotions because there was a mechanical perfection to the way in which the stone had been polished. And he saw the same potential in the car you see at the bottom. He saw the same potential for creating new types of volumes, new types of shapes, with new finishes, which would be carriers of poetic meaning.
So he's clearly aspiring at a synthesis between the poetics of Greek architecture and, the mathematical correctness, let's say, of the machines that were invented in this period. And I just wanted to move to his fascination by modern transportation, including the, of course, the car, the train car, the airplane, the ocean liner, which had by this point achieved, especially the automobile, a degree of standardization and mass production, and a certain aesthetic as well. How did these this issue, the mass production of the car, in its very functional appearance, how did it shape his approach to architecture, including perhaps its mass production?
Yeah, here we see. I'm sorry, you can't see them very well. we see a page of a book. It's great that I put together these slides today. But you see on the right a page of the version architecture. It's called Maison en série, mass-produced houses. But the image, and it's exactly a paradox, the image is not a building. It's a car with an open door. So what is the meaning of this car with an open door? It means that, first of all, cars are produced industrially. And Le Corbusier, at that time, owned a little Ford car. And he was totally aware, as were most intellectuals of Europe, of what was emerging in the US. He was an ardent propagandist for scientific management, for Taylorism, and Fordism. This is one aspect. The car can be produced in a factory. And therefore, we have to think of such factories for houses. Then there is another idea which is really interesting, which you can grasp from this image. Le Corbusier says, let's call him Corbu. Back to that. He says, he writes, what is remarkable about this car is that people can enter the car through, let's say, 50 centimeters or 45 centimeters wide door. This is a demonstration that houses could have much smaller dimensions and that we could build many more minimal houses. Mm-hmm. So in another book, his ideal of a living cell was the ocean liner cabin. So in a way, the car was also a lesson in the miniaturization of domestic space, which was a big issue in the 20s and 30s, when the housing shortage in Europe in particular, but also in America, forced the development of what was called the minimal housing, the first massive campaign for the construction of social housing. So the car became a sort of model for that. And then there are many other levels. Another level can be purely material, looking at the way in which the stressed skin bodies of cars were made in order to design building components which would be conceived and produced like car parts. So it's a very rich analogy.
Well, I wonder if there's not a problem in that, namely that in his reliance on engineering, American engineering, and his inspiration from the motor vehicle, Le Car, was he being perhaps a technological reductionist? Or did he hope to find an entirely new means for architectural expression that is based on mass production?
No, I think what is really puzzling is the endless duality and ambiguity of a man. In a letter of 1926, he writes, I am a double character. On one side, there is Jeanneret, his real name, the poet, the painter, the one who dreams and who makes shapes. And on the other side, there is Le Corbusier, the prophet. So poet, prophet, the man who preaches for absolute solutions. And so if you go and look at the buildings, you will find examples of these productive ambiguities. If we look at Ronchamp on the right, it derives altogether, and I'm not entering into details, but you can find in this building, in the roof, the structure of an airplane wing. Mm-hmm. It's conceived as an airplane wing. It also derives, he wrote once, from a crab shell he had found on a beach in Long Island.
and other features of the house derived from his observations of Villa Adriana near Rome. So he was capable, and this is what good architects are capable of doing, of abstracting a completely unexpected shape out of the combination of various types of inspiration. But he remained, and you were right, a complete fanatic of the airplane. So when he flew to when he was flying continuously from Paris to India to build Chandigarh, he sent memos to Air India explaining them how they needed to paint their airplanes in order to make them look more modern. He tried to sell a design for an ocean liner to the Compagnie Générale Transatlantique. He designed and patented an automobile in the 1930s after a bid by a tender by Citroën. So in a way, the mechanical object was of his generation of young kids who were there when cinema was invented, when the Panama Canal was open, when the Wright brothers started flying. One of his most vivid recollections is the recollection of Blériot flying over Paris, Blériot who crossed the Channel exactly 100 years ago. So he was a man of his time from this point of view, with all the illusions of what I would call the fetishism of the machine.
That's wonderful. And I think what really balances this technological vision is that his deep knowledge and his strong sympathy, empathy with Greek architecture. I remember we were just looking at images of his drawings of the Acropolis, of different buildings, the Parthenon in the Acropolis, in terms of planning, in terms of design, in terms of its response to the site. What lessons, if you could summarize, did he learn from Greek architecture?
Yes, I can. Yes, I wanted to show you this is what we can do with these machines. I'm just fishing in my vast network, storage of images to show you Jeanneret as a young man on the Acropolis in 1911. So he spent maybe one entire week climbing on the Acropolis every day when he was in Athens in 1911, and he drew many lessons. So one was observing the Parthenon measuring the Parthenon and thinking about what he would call the mechanical and also the psychological perfection of the Parthenon. And this is perfectly rendered in Toward an Architecture. But he also looked at other aspects. He looked at also at the plan of the Acropolis as such. And here is another image, which is, by the way, upside down, but I can put it back. And okay, so look at this image, which shows you it's from Vers une architecture. It's an image on top, which comes from a book by Auguste Choisy, History of Architecture, published around 1900, in which Choisy discussed not only the buildings individually, but their placement, and in particular the experience of movement, of pedestrian movement, from one building to the other. From this analysis of the Acropolis, Le Corbusier drew one of the key concepts of his entire work, namely the architectural promenade, the idea that a building, which is really typical of his designs, the idea that a building, a house, a public building, can be understood as a sequence of vistas, as a sequence of spatial experiences which are organized like a promenade, in analogy with the processions which were taking place on the Acropolis in ancient times. So we see again, as in the case of the automobile, the powerful metaphoric ability of Le Corbusier at drawing ideas at different scales and in different domains from a single, and in this case, very complex object.
I think that's very vividly clear, this idea of the promenade and how it's inspired by the sighting of the monuments on the Acropolis. I wanted to get back to more of the architecture of Greek architecture as such, which on the one hand appears very mathematically correct, almost rigid, but we know that Greek architecture has many optical corrections. It responds to the site, it responds to the mass, it responds to its own weight. Is that even possible in an architecture made out of reinforced concrete? And is did they concern Corbusier and other modernists?
Yeah, I think the ideal of responding to Greek architecture is one which develops already in the 19th century. And one of Le Corbusier's mentors, he had a series of mentors in the early years of his life. One of them was a French architect called Auguste Perret, who was probably the first architect to really try to understand the potential of reinforced concrete. So he designed extremely beautiful and complex concrete structures. Young Le Corbusier worked with him for more than a year, and Perret tried to think of the possibility of a modern order made out of concrete, in which the column, in which the architrave, in which the capital would be reconceived, not by repeating the Greek ornamental spectrum, not by producing a new Doric, but by thinking about the way in which the properties of the Doric, which were in fact a sort of visual translation of the laws of stone masonry, how this could be implemented and developed for concrete. So in a way, having a capital which would tell a story about the steel reinforcing rods, which were invisible and yet so important within the mass of poured concrete. Mm-hmm. So in this context, Le Corbusier also worked on echoing the sense of the material of the Greeks with different technologies.
That sort of predicts my next question, which was on how, because you know he's not the only one who looked at Greek architecture. Sure. Greek architecture had always been an inspiration for successive generations, but especially with the neoclassical architects. And how would you summarize, I mean, I think you've already said that, but if you would like to expand a little bit on how he differed in how he was inspired by Greek architecture from such architects, I don't know, as Ledoux, for example, or...
No, if we take architects of the 18th century like Ledoux, of the early 19th century like Schinkel, in Berlin, they had what I would call a literal relationship to classicism. Or to put it in other terms, I would use an interpretive construction which has been proposed by Sigmund Freud, in which he contrasts the manifest and the latent content of situations and of dreams, in particular by working on the interpretation of dreams. So in dealing with classicism, there is a manifest classicism, which is based on recycling the classical elements as such and on insisting on the exactness of the reproduction of their proportions and their detailing. And there is a latent classicism, which is trying to go beyond the surface of the classical ornaments to what they tell about the art of architecture, about structural honesty, about proportion, about optical manipulation. And this is clear when you look at Ronchamp and the way in which Ronchamp grows out of the ground. It's clear that the lesson of the optical correction of the Parthenon has not been lost. So I would say that Le Corbusier is a latent classicism and certainly not a manifest one.
Yes. I mean, I look at Corbusier's buildings. I don't know them as intimately or nearly as intimately as you do, but they seem to me more closely in harmony with Greek architecture. I don't see in them the spatial quality of Roman architecture, but maybe I'm missing something. Was he equally inspired by that as well?
Probably not as much by Roman architecture, yet he looked He looked at the Pantheon in great detail. I can show you just to document my discourse. For instance, a sketch he made of the Pantheon. He was interested in a different thing in Roman architecture. He was interested in, and this sketch of 1911, he was then 24. So this is part of a sketchbook, which has been, by the way, reprinted. Everything, all the sketches from his early trips can be found in the exquisite reprints and affordable ones. So what we see here is that the Parthenon is important because of the relationship between these elementary volumes, between the triangular shape of the pediment, between the orthogonal relationship of columns and architrave, and of course the contrast of these two families of forms with the cylinder and the round forms of the main room of the building. So it drew lessons of what I would call about elementary form from the Roman architecture, but also he was also interested in the in two other aspects. One is Roman infrastructures. He was extremely alert to the and interested in the big aqueducts and in the large structures which were reacting against the landscape. And if you remember my image of the Algiers plan, the idea of what he called an inhabitable motorway.
Inhabitable.
A motorway which would be used to as a carrier, as a structure in which housing would be inserted. Mm-hmm. He was interested in the contrast between the horizontal of the motorway and the hilly landscape of Algiers, and this came out from his observation of Roman aqueducts. And another theme he developed in the last parts of his life, he was interested in the dark building, in the big black box. And this is, I think, also a derivation from his observations of Villa Adriana, of the large, big imperial baths in Rome. So there is also a Roman aspect. He was, above all, using the Roman example. For instance, we have not discussed Le Corbusier's politics, and this could take us very, very far. But when, after having courted Stalin in vain, even if he built his major structure of the interwar years in Moscow, which is still standing, he tried to court Mussolini. Of course, he invoked the greatness of the Romans in order to position himself as a potential builder of new grand structures for the fascist regime.
Well, it's coming a little closer to home, but I would like to bring it a little closer and look at, let us think of Istanbul, Constantinople. We looked at some images of Constantinople, drawings that he made, and I remember seeing them, not quite these, but others that were more sort of the location of Ottoman structures, and you know, many of you here have been to Istanbul, the location of Ottoman structures or the Hagia Sophia on the hills of Constantinople, as seen from across the Golden Horn. What was Corbusier's interest in that city, whether in its monumental architecture or in vernacular Turkish architecture?
I think it's a very interesting question, and you see I'm ready to extract some images, some more images, but because I think one needs to see these images. Le Corbusier had a very complex relationship to Constantinople. Yes, I can take an image from a vernacular house, which is very beautiful. So again, 1911, the date is wrong, but he postdated later the drawing. So he looked at Turkish houses, and it brought back to Europe some features of his Turkish houses, in particular in the first buildings he made in his hometown of La Chaux-de-Fonds. But he was also interested in the landscape, as we see from these fabulous watercolors. They're very small. I mean, they're probably their real size is a quarter of an A4 sheet. So it's a little, excessive to show them on a screen like that. But you understand that he was interested in the silhouette of the city, and in the relationship, in the importance already of the architectural objects in the city. Here we see how the silhouette is characterized by simply the profile of some of the big mosques of Istanbul. And this idea that the city is made of big buildings which are in a conversation develops through the sketch of Rome and later to his project. As long as he was the one designing these buildings, as is Chandigarh, it was fine. But when lousy architects and what I would say opportunistic city planners generalized this concept, this led to some of the worst planning and architectural disasters of human history. So what makes Le Corbusier great is not his ideas, but the fact that when he himself implemented his ideas, he made it with not fearing to contradict himself, with great virtuosity.
It's obvious that Corbu had great loves and great hates. He there's an extreme element. But one thing that he seems to have detested was Beaux-Arts architecture, which I actually like. I mean, call me a bourgeois conservative, but I find in Beaux-Arts architecture in Paris, and walking in the streets of Paris, that it structures the environment, it structures even my movement within the environment, whereas I find that somewhat lost in the architecture of modernism, which appears as aloof objects suitable to office parks or to Hilton hotels. Was that a paradox of interest to Corbu, and did he attempt to any kind of a happy medium? I doubt that, but
it is a very complex issue. I'm showing on the screen in the meantime, and I can share it with you. Another aspect of Le Corbusier's experience in Istanbul, which was is here in posing as a woman and dancing in a photo made by one of his travel companions. He discovered during his travel many other things, including sexuality. And it's important to say before I'm returning to your question that among his many aspects of Le Corbusier, there is also a very profound passion for eroticism. And even sometimes on the edge of pornography, in some of the drawings he made in places of ill repute throughout his life. So Le Corbusier was this duality, he can be seen as a dogmatic, but at the same time he's a very sensuous type of person. He was a very sensuous. So the question of the Beaux-Arts, it's clear that the Beaux-Arts have made, modernized classicism, uh-huh, has produced extraordinary structures like, I don't know, Grand Central Station in New York, or like Lutyens, New Delhi in India, and also great cities like Regent's Park, the buildings on the edge of Regent's Park, like Haussmann's Paris, etc. So this kind of classicism has produced remarkable continuous city and remarkable monumental complexes. When you break the rule and start thinking that every building should be original, you need virtuoso architects to make them. And this is almost this has almost never been achieved. If in today's world we look, for example, at successful urban developments in which modern architecture has been used, we could count them on the fingers of one hand, probably. I will only give an example, which is probably the best case in the encounter between architecture and the city, the case of Barcelona. Barcelona has produced interesting new neighborhoods with buildings which are not classical and not nostalgic because of the quality of the architectural culture. And when I mean quality of architectural culture, it's not the quality of the individual designer. It's the quality of the designers, the quality of the clients, of the public clients, very well aware of what the city is, and the quality of the public debate in which a bad building gets heavy flack and its architect gets into trouble. So you need extraordinary conditions. Mm-hmm. To have this happen. It has happened also in some parts of Manhattan. Mm-hmm. I mean, who could pretend that parts of Manhattan like Park Avenue, the lower part of North Park Avenue is an extraordinary conversation between modernist structures, but it was done in the context of an elite design professionals negotiating with elite patrons.
Well, I think you've convinced me in these specific cases. Now, I really want to bring it home here to the Gulf area. It has been suggested that Corbusier's vision, were it to succeed, would need strong government, vast expanses, and lots of money. These did not exist in any of the European capitals, a layered city, self-governed cities like Paris or Berlin. That would not work. Would his vision achieve greater success in the Gulf?
It's a tricky question. I'm not sure. I think, first of all, his vision was not a vision, one single vision. Again, the plan voisin and the idea of completely raising the center of Paris to build freeways and glass office towers was one. What you've seen with the Algiers plan, replacing the entire structure of the city or placing on top of the existing structure of the city a new system of freeways and freely composed large houses was one. If you look at Chandigarh, where he designed the major public buildings, but where he interpreted an interior plan made by two American architects, Albert Mayer and Clarence Stein, who had worked for Nehru before Nehru, called Le Corbusier. You have a really successful city, which has developed well, and in which the specific conditions of India, natural and cultural, have been taken into account. So if this is Le Corbusier's idea of a city, I think it's valid. Okay. If we want to reproduce the plan voisin with its freeways and its empty glass towers, it has been made in many cities. It's, in a way, he was prophetic in imagining what the age of mass production could produce. I'm not sure that this is the alternative we want for cities in this region or in any other region.
Right. I have one last question before we open it to the our great public here. You've suggested that Verzun architecture may have been even more important than or influential than Corbusier's architecture itself. Would you like to elaborate on that?
Yeah, I would say that ever since the invention of a printing press, architecture has developed along two ways, the book and the building. Palladio built a series of villas, but most architects discovered them in Palladio's Quattro Libri, in his book, or in Vignola's interpretation of Palladio. And this would be true also throughout the 19th century.
It's clear that the work of Wright, Frank Lloyd Wright, has been propagated by his buildings, but also by his autobiography, a very carefully carved lie, but over hundreds of pages, but a very seductive one. And if we take
contemporary architects, it's clear that the position of Rem Koolhaas on today's contemporary scene is due to his fabulous book on New York, Delirious New York of 1978, which, by the way, derives in part from Le Corbusier's Verzun architecture, if you look at it in detail. Instead of telling, look at airplanes and look at automobiles, he says, look at the non-heroic buildings of Manhattan, and you learn something about the which will help you to deal with today's problems. If you look at Robert Venturi's production, Venturi, as who is, in my view, very important architect of the, let's say, the third quarter, to try to put it precisely, the third quarter of the 20th century, Venturi's contribution is essentially defined by two books, Complexity and Contradiction in Architecture of 66, and his great Learning from Las Vegas, which in a way helped generations of architects and readers to understand not Las Vegas, but the suburbs of the entire planet. So I think that in contrast to what you remember, of course, you're familiar with with Victor Hugo's statement in The Hunchback of Notre Dame, Notre Dame de Paris, known in a popular way as translated The Hunchback of Notre Dame. He wrote, ceci tuera cela, this will kill that, the book will kill the building. In fact, the book has not killed the building. The book has helped the building to grow, and this is, even in this age where books are problematic objects, this remain, I think, very true.
What a wonderful conclusion. Architects should write. By writing, I think you propagate your ideas. I'm reminded of when they asked Winston Churchill, will history be kind to you? He said, of course history will be kind to you. I intend to write, history will be kind to me. I intend to write it myself. So.
1 question about, you mentioned Mussolini, you mentioned Stalin, you mentioned an interesting time in the early 20th century. I would like you to comment, please, on Le Corbusier and his maybe artistic side. Did it influence the futurist art movement that was very famous in the Italian context of the 20s? They had a fascination with machinery, the machinery of war, if you would. Thank you.
Yes, I think it's an interesting question. In fact, they were strictly contemporary. You know that futurists started with a manifesto published by Marinetti exactly 100 years ago, February 20th, 2009, in Paris, celebrating the machine. Le Corbusier didn't know this text, but he knew the futurists. He was in contact with some futurists. He was in particular in contact with Severini, who was living in Paris. But he was more attracted, and again, if you read L'Esprit Nouveau, which has been reprinted, if you read Vers sur l'architecture, he was more interested in the early part of his life to what I would call the neoclassical component of Italian culture, the component called, and in particular to Valori Plastici and Chirico. But if one enlarges the frame, and one looks at this question of a machine, we find many, many architects of Le Corbusier generation who are really trying to find in the machine the root of a new aesthetics. You find Frank Lloyd Wright, who wrote in 1901 a major essay called The Arts and Crafts of a Machine. You find, of course, the founders of the German Werkbund, who will later be active inside the Bauhaus, like Gropius and others. You find the Dutch functionalists. You find the Russian constructivists, who had a very, very significant input in the interpretation of not only of the machine, but of the factory as a global system. And Le Corbusier was trying to weave his own thread his own fabric between these positions. So in opposition with the extreme functionalists of the Germans, in contrast to some aesthetic aspects of the futurist strategies he disliked, he designed his own line, but not without being aware of everything around him. As his library shows, for instance, his library has been largely preserved, so it's possible to look in his books and see where the books he had. in his correspondence, he was a man of letters, if I may so, because he wrote books, but also he wrote many letters. And many of the intimate episodes, even in his professional life, can be grasped from his correspondence with his mother. He wrote to his mom at least once a week between 1907, when he started his first trip to Tuscany, to his mother's death in 1960, at the age of 100 years. So for more than, more than 50 years, he had his mother as a confidant. For all sorts of Freudian reasons, I don't need to elaborate here. So, but what I say is that we can, these responses can be documented, his response to the other movements can be documented by what he published and by what he wrote without publishing it to his mothers, to his partners. He was an extremely reactive, and this is what makes great architects. Great architects are not autistic characters. There are people who look at the world, who absorb the world critically, who sometimes thereafter hiding their sources. This is what most architects do, but they, first of all, are great observers. And I think what another lesson, if you want to draw a lesson from, to learn something from toward an architecture, is this practice of observation. When Kohlhaas published after Delirious New York other interpretations of what was happening in China, he was in a certain way continuing this posture, which has been so productive.
Corbusier's mission was to rationalize architecture, and as an artist, he used the rational to eradicate the unnecessary. Do you find it ironic that today it's a machine that allows architects to become completely irrational again and to break all the boundaries of rationality because the computer allows them to create dancing buildings and erotic bananas for towers in the middle of Abu Dhabi, things that have no logic but are actually beautiful pieces of architecture. Would you say that he would have responded to these flying bananas?
There is a component, of course, of plastic research in his work. Again, look at Ronchamp. Ronchamp surprised completely, and I could show you Ronchamp again, but I don't need to. Ronchamp shocked all the supporters of Le Corbusier.
Yes.
Because they were not expecting that, and they had to adapt. No one was less Corbusian than Corbusier. He reminds me of what Karl Marx, I'm today referring to great figures, but Karl Marx once said, at least I'm not a Marxist. Meaning that he was not a prisoner of the cliché which were propagated about his thought. And it's true for Le Corbusier, he was not a Corbusian, he was capable of completely changing the rules of the game. And he was, and in this I will challenge your initial consideration, he was not a functionalist, and there was one rule at the atelier where he in his office, you were not it was not tolerated to justify a drawing or a figure saying it functions. It had to have also a more elevated purpose. And I'll take you, I'll point you to a caricature he made in a very important article of of the early 1930s. He wrote this article in opposition, in contrast to the German functionalists, who were saying that the form is an equation of material times economy. Hannes Meyer, the second director of the Bauhaus. Le Corbusier said, no, you can't say that because it is an object is functional, is beautiful. And I give you an example. This is the way he wrote in this essay called In Defense of Architecture. There is a wire mesh basket in my office on the left, okay? I kick it. It becomes larger. It contains much more waste paper. But you can't say that if it's more useful now, it's more beautiful than the one on the left. Okay? So he was, again, I'm hiding behind it, his considerations, but he was adamant not to be only in the realm of rationality. And again, what is touching in Le Corbusier is not the dogmatic aspect, it's the human aspect of this guy contradicting himself. So and being self-consciously at least double, so trying to implement solutions which were rational, but at the same time, in a way, undermining them when he was starting to design things in a more precise way.
This is another question about the machine and the classical architecture. As early as the 17th century, Claude Perrault talked about two examples of where architecture could be exact, otherwise it's all proportions. One of them being the machine, the other one being the theater set, where you're actually doing a historic play and then you have to be faithful to the period you're explaining. Does Le Corbusier ever refer to this, place himself in that tradition, context, or, and if he does, when or where?
Not clearly, because I don't think he mentions Perrault very much. He's much more interested and already in Vesuvian architecture in the other direction of French architecture, which is the classicism of the academic classicism of Blondel, and then the games of Blondel the Younger in terms of the distribution of plans, the way in which plans had to be composed. So I don't think he was a great reader of Perrault. He had read Perrault's translation of the translation of Vitruvius, which had been illustrated by Perrault. But there are intermediate stages between the 17th century and the early years of Le Corbusier's education in around 1900. He was, for instance, a great reader of Ruskin, and with Ruskin preaching honesty, the lamp of truth in his Seven Lamps of Architecture of 1849. He was also a great reader of Viollet-le-Duc, this great 19th century French architecture restorer, theorist, teacher, who in his lectures on architecture, which were read not only by Le Corbusier, but also by Louis Sullivan in the US, or by Frank Lloyd Wright, had an interesting and really significant reflection, for instance, on the question of style, which is one of the bases of Le Corbusier's reflection. Viollet-le-Duc opposes to the styles with an S, the style plural, the historical styles, the notion of style, of, in a way, the adequate adjustment of form to the use and to the times. And he says, even if they do not obey to, he writes, even if they do not obey to the laws of classical art, a railway engine and an ocean liner can have style without S. So this idea that machines could be carriers of course, principle of rational composition, rational assembly of spaces. The ocean liner was a great model for the functional organization of a city, because as Le Corbusier writes, in an ocean liner, everything is rangé, everything is ordered, but at the same time, because it is aerodynamic, because it is studied as a pure object with the on the base of the laws of economy, the ocean liner can have style. So there is what I would say is that there is Le Corbusier's work, and again, this is what makes this guy irresistible sometimes, and that pushes me to. Try to, although I'm trying to resist and work on other topics, return to his work in many ways, in many loops. What is interesting is this ability at, in a way, integrating layers and layers of discourse into his, and also literary discourse in his work. He was, at the end of his life, he was reading essentially Don Quixote and Rabelais.
First of all, thank you very, very much for coming to Abu Dhabi and giving us such a nice inspection of quality that I haven't seen here for a long time. Appreciate that. I was asking maybe if you would care to, or can I ask you to speculate a little bit, do you see his spirit in any of today's architects, and how do you think you would have used today's virtual books?
Well, I think it's very difficult to project this history into the future, into the present or the future. I would say, I would return to my Freudian formula, latent and manifest, latent and explicit. There is today, of course, an explicit Corbusianism, and it started already in the 1920s. When Le Corbusier went to Moscow for the first time in 1928, he saw buildings which were much larger than his own, but which were implementing his ideas about form. The pilotis, the ribbon window, the flat roof, 10 times larger than his own buildings. So Corbusianism started already, I mean, the dissemination of Corbusian features started very early and continues. There are architects who continue to practice what I would call a Corbusian mannerism. So this is not, of course, what where the relevance of his work here. I think the relevance is more a more latent one. Is again in observing the real city, observing things that happen around us, observing technologies, and today the technologies. One, I could paraphrase Le Corbusier, eyes that do not see. For him, eyes were not seeing airplanes, ocean liners, and motor cars. I could say today, eyes that do not see microbiology, eyes that do not see climate change, maybe, or that do not see computer science. Anyway, this alertness and this ability at resourcing architecture in other disciplines remains a key position today. And so for me, this is just one example. For me, the lesson of Le Corbusier is not a lesson in form, in continuing to pretend that the forms he has designed have a relevance today. Industrialized Corbusier is awful. Computer-aided Corbusier is ridiculous. What is important is this lesson of observation, and also, of course, a lesson in what are the traditional tools of the architects, and I don't think that good proportion is dead, even if when building absolutely incomprehensible objects. I know Frank Gehry very well. I see Gehry at work, and I saw him at work on his Abu Dhabi project in May. He was constantly reshaping his funnels. He would never have said that he was, because he probably doesn't use the term, that he was preoccupied by their proportion, but he was constantly reshaping them and keeping in mind a notion of stable unbalance, which could be referred to some of Le Corbusier's compositions, although Gehry certainly is not a great Corbusier fan. So I think there are a series. What we can draw from that is clearly not in the doesn't belong to the realm of imitation or direct transformation, but to a more indirect mental attitude towards the way we live in.
Thank you both, Yasser and Jean-Louis, for restoring Corbusier and Versus une architecture in such an extremely spirited conversation, and thank you for helping them draw out these implications in your questions. I think that together, Yasser and Jean-Louis, in what they've said, have encouraged all of us to go forth, and not just into the Gulf, but right here in Abu Dhabi, picking up Jean-Louis' comments on Freudian recovery, to go look for what you could say the Corbusian unconscious in Abu Dhabi and see what you can find. And certainly images came to mind as I listened to your exposition and also saw these images. So I think it's a great plea for attentiveness in ourselves, I think, to our architectural environments, that kind of alertness that you talk about. So thank you so very much for that. I hope that you will stay for more conversation at the reception. And of course, we hope to see all of you back, I think on October 15th, when we will consider some very special aspect of urban planning and architecture in and unusual in Abu Dhabi. We'll have a very lively panel here, I think, with extremely expert speakers on the completion of the Formula One circuit 2 weeks before the Grand Prix of Abu Dhabi. Come to our panel, Completing the Circuit, Formula One, Yas Island, and the Future of Abu Dhabi. That's in 2 weeks now. But for now, please thank again our wonderful speakers.